today. So thank you everyone for being here. I hope I'm going to have an entertaining and nice talk like the previous speaker. So I'm going to talk about the photoemission spectroscopy, and I hope I'll give you an overview of where the technique is today and how many more things that we can do to learn about the correlation material in general and many other systems. So I will start with a brief introduction about the technique. It's actually a relatively old technique that you will see, but it's still actually new. I will talk about just a little bit about the past, present and future of the spectroscopy. And I will focus on two aspects of the present and future, which are the spin result of the emission spectroscopy and time result of the emission spectroscopy. And as I go through this, I will focus on a couple of examples. And in particular, I will talk about a little bit about topological insulator here, and about coup rates in the case of time resolved arcs. So, photoemission spectroscopy is, as I told you before, is a relatively old technique because it really goes back to the discovery of the photoelectric effect in 1887 by Earth, and then followed later on by the explanation of Einstein, whom he was awarded the Nobel Prize. And here we have the idea, the basic idea is that you have you shine a sample with light, with photons, and you can emit an electron if you have the proper energy for the photon. This idea was later on explored experimentally by Sigmund, who got actually in 1981 the Nobel Prize. And the idea was to develop an experimental apparatus that allows that you actually ponder these electrons, photoelectrons that were emitted from the solar. And the whole idea, the basic idea was once we can get this photoelectron and we can directly measure the kinetic energy of this electron, then we can learn about the energy that the electron can share. And actually, Kai Sigmund was the first one to develop this type of electron analyzer. Today is actually the modern figure of a picture of an analyzer. The one he developed was one of the first one. But the whole idea, actually, the concept is pretty similar to what we use today. And he used this technique to prove that you actually can get information about electrons where they are in the solid. And in particular, it was focusing on core electrons, so it was looking at very high energy. And here is one of the work with the technique showing that you can actually, if you look at the carbon on its layer, now you can get information about the way the carbon is bounded with different atoms. And so this technique has been used a lot over the past and was a slightly different name than what we know today. And the name was electron spectroscopy for chemical analysis, or also known as ASCAM, and today also HDS. So the main the advancement brought by Sigmund was to introduce electron analyzers, so to the idea that actually we can use these emitted electrons to learn about the property of the material. Now you can see that you get the same concept can be applied not only if you look at the core electrons, but also if you look at the valence electrons. You know, when you start to look at the valence electrons, a lot of new information in physics come out. And this concept was pushed over 20 years. And now we move really 40 years. And in 40 years, we saw a lot of improvement in the technique. The concept is still the same. You have a photon coming in, electron coming out. This detector has become a commercial detector. There have been a lot of companies that have been pushing the state of art of the system. And the idea was now, well, we are measuring the energy of the upcoming electron, but actually we can also get information about the initial electron. And the initial electron is related with the momentum of the electron inside the solid. Now we can not only look at the energy of the emitted electron, but also about their momentum. And so we can do, and once we can do this, we can get the full value mapping of the property of the electron. So, for example, if we focus with the valence electron in this particular case, you can look along the different symmetry direction, and you can map, these are the experimental data points, you can map the different dispersion along the different symmetry direction. It's actually a very old work by Dinger on the great superconductor of this particular field, I believe. So I like this work, I use it a lot. It's very nice also because you can see now that you can extend the technique and you can start to scan just electrons that are emitted as a perimeter. And you can use it in the moment, looking at the momentum space. And when you do this, you can start to get map of the fermi surface of the electron. For example, here we just look at the half of the fermi surface, and you can look at this you see that you can start to get information about material. So you can start to look, for example, if the system is, you look at the gap. You can start to look at the symmetry of the gap. Now, no need to say that there are obviously limitations, because you see here that this straight line at the theory and this point here at the data. So we have very little point. So we need to do better. And the need to do better came with the development once again. The development of vector detector. So these are the state of art of what you can do today. Now you can map the state of it just one data point at a time. You can map in the full momentum in the energy space the dispersion of the system. So for example, these are the theoretic system. You've seen along various directions the different length. You can focus on the Fermi level, for example, look at, and look at the Fermi surface here. So the technique today has evolved to really a very different and more advanced status that it was many years ago. So now you look at this and you can say, well, I can expand a bit what this technique can do, and I can not only look at the band mapping or just map the Fermi surface, but I can really, by knowing what I mentioned, I can look at, start to look at other information such as like self-energy physical interaction. Because if we actually we go back a moment and look at the way we can write this photocorrent. The photocorrent is nothing else than what we measure. And if you wanted the number of electrons that reach your analyzer, this quantity here is directly proportional to the Fermi function. Obviously, we are measuring photoelectric effect, so we only measure the occupied state. But it's also directly proportional to this quantity here, which is the spectral function. There are several states which I have obviously not shown here to show that the photocorrent is directly proportional to the spectral function. And the spectral function is nothing else than a function that contains all the information about the self-energy and sigma k and omega. So once you measure this photocorrent, you're actually directly probing the self-energy of the system. So we want to find a way of extracting this information. And this is possible today if I just take here, this is an old work by itself, obviously this is to do what you are in this particular direction. And these were the few data points you could take today. And these are the type of spectra you can use in the past, and these are the type of spectra you can do today. So when you look at this, you see that now, just focusing here, where in the past we have data point, you can start to really look at the detail of the dispersion. So for example, in this case, you can look at the dispersion to see that there is a change in the dispersion, which is nothing else a change of velocity or a change of the effective mass, and so you can extract information on the electron of the interaction. So really, the technique takes the improvement of this analyzer and evolved to a different level. You can do much, much more. So this is complicated, just to give you a flash of other things you can do. You can use also the technique, for example, to extract information on the very face of the material. This is the work we've done in my group a few years ago, where we looked at layer by layer ravine, and by looking at the so-called mixed intensity, these are the XKY maps, so these are Fermi surface mass, taken somewhere here and somewhere down here, you see that there is a missing intensity. You would expect the Fermi surface to be a closed circle, and you see that there is a missing intensity. Same thing when you look at it by layer. And by looking at the missing intensity, actually in the group doing a polarization-dependent study, you can extract information on the very face of the system. So there is much, much more than actors for the mission can do, and the question is, well, we have seen how over the past really 20 years, the data so much and how many information we have gained. And I mean, because of purpose of time, I haven't gone through all the beautiful discoveries that this technique has made in a lot of related material. I would say especially in the case of compressible conductors. So there is much, much more than we can do. And so today I'm just going to focus on a few things. And as I'm writing here, a few of the possible expansion of the technique, but the reality is that actually there are many more that I haven't even put here in this report. So, the obvious thing is to extend the technique to the speed. Because if you think about the whole process of the photoelectric effect, when the electron comes out, the electron contains information about the speed. The speed is a quantum number, so it's there. You just don't measure it, you just measure the charge, measure a photocorrent, but the speed information is there. So we need to find a way of extracting it. And people have done it in the past, but you haven't heard much about the technique, and in a moment I'll explain why. The next frontier is really to push it to the time real, just like optical experiments have done over the past 20 years. And it would be very nice to be able to do quantum probe for the Photoemission experiment. These are possible today, but we are really looking at the tip of the iceberg. There's much, much more that we can do. given this type of experiment, and I hope and pray you are awaiting for improvement in instrumentation and especially in the laser field. A beautiful video to do nano result for the mission experiment, and there are many materials because of competition in the system and double segregation in different phases and different structural regions of existing. And you see it in a variety of systems, petroleum, compressive conductors, CMR material, graphene, a variety of systems. We know that the charge, the way the charge can be arranged is not homogeneous. And today there are obviously limitations for the technique, but there have been a lot of experimental development, and a fast light source that is now a new line that can operate the 100 nano. So we are getting there, not there yet, but we are getting there. Ambient pressure would be another beautiful experiment because we allow to expand the technique to a variety of systems, also organic materials that are most possible to study today. And obviously we can think of adding magnetic field, adding with broader restriction magnetic field, adding pressure. There is much more that can be done. In the past, in the previous talk, was not saying much, but we have a group now that are doing it in the situ. So you grow material in situ and you look at the elements of the mission. There is really a lot. I'm just going to focus today on these few particular aspects of the data. Let me briefly go to the spin part. So the concept is the electron come out, you want to be able to build in your detector some sort of spin filter. What you really want is a spin filter that filters the component of the spin that you want to measure. And obviously some sort of semi-relaxed system, but that would be good for the electrons. The other thing is to do pump and probe. So you first come in with the pump, you excite the system, and you can excite it in various ways. You will see in which way you can excite depending on the pump probe. And then you come in with the probe, and you do the usual process of the Photoemission experiment. So these are the two aspects I'm going to focus on. I'm going to start to break off spin Photoemission experiment. So how do we build this type of spin filter? I was talking about this before. And if you go in the literature, there are actually several work that have been done in the past 30 years. And then the technique has been forgotten for a while, and with the discovery of topological insulator, it's been kind of rediscovered again. Because obviously those are material where the main property are based on this beautiful spin texture that we see for the surface electrons. So you really need a technique that allows you to map in the momentum space the spin texture. And that's why people have remembered about the technique. So what is the principle? The principle on which the technique has worked so far is based on the spin orbit interaction. So the idea is that you have your usual division process. So here you have a sample, you shine your sample, pretty much this process. Photons, electrons come out and go in your analyzer. And this part here, if you would stop here, these are the artist experiments we've done. So now what we do, when these electrons come out, we have another one. When these electrons come out, you make them scatter with a target, which is a material that has a high spin orbit interaction. So when you do this now, because of the spin orbit interaction of Newtonian, you are able to separate. So if you want to build the spin filter we were talking about and separate the electrons, then they have different spin component. Spin up and spin down. They're going to have a few different scattering probability. And so you make them, after they scatter with the spin orbit material, you make them go here and you separate the two spin components. So now the experiment is the same, but the only difference is that at the end, whenever you come up with a map, or a data point that reflects only the electron that has one particular spin component, or on the other hand, the other particular spin component. So people have done this experiment, and the problem to do this is that when you compare with what you can do with artists today, so artists, you are here, the spin artists will be somewhere over here. So this is the beautiful data you can take with artists today, and with spin artists, you suffer by many things. But really, the biggest suffering is the low count rate of the field. So that you lose a lot of electron going through this process here. And because of this, obviously your energy contribution is poor, so it's going to suffer. But most of all, the way these detectors are built, you have what we call a zero D detection, which in other terms is nothing else than this. You do the full experiment, and when you stop here, you have all this set of data, thousands and thousands and thousands of data. But when you come here, now you have just one data. So we go back really like 50 years on the ventilators, with the ventilators. So the experiments are really painful. The energy momentum resolution, most experiments is of the order of 50 millielectronvolt versus 1 or 2 millielectronvolt of correct photoemission experiment. And so obviously they are rooted, you probe some material, but in most of the case, they are not really exciting. So in the case, I just want to give you an example of the data you can take when you use this type of system. And the system based on the spin orbit coupling are called minimal to detect. And the, these are ARPES data, looking at the Rajba state of both. And you know that because of the Rajba splitting, you're going to see two different factors, which have different spin configuration, spin up and spin down. And here I indicated them with a different color. So when you do an ARPES experiment, and you look at the energy versus momentum, you see that you have two bands, but you actually don't know anything about the spin of this band, because you are not resolving the spin. But now if you do the same experiment, adding this other part of the detector, now you can resolve the spin. So what you can do here, you cannot take data in this matter, but you can take one single data point, for example, along this line. And when you do this, these are the data you see. So you're going to see that you have one spin component, and then you call it spin up, which is closer to the third layer. So when I come down, I'm going to first cross this blue band, and I'm going to have a component. And then when I go down, I'm going to have another band, which has mainly red character, so it's the down component. So I can, if I would do this and take many, many, many spectra, then I would be able to reconstruct this. But taking the spectra takes a lot of time. And you see also that the data quality is pretty good. Eventually, if you think about the theory, you should have only one peak here and the red peak here. But you see that there is a lot of stuff in between. This is because the resolution, the energy and momentum resolution is not good. So you can start to see something that is not ideal. So how can we overcome this? And since the technique is old, but it's actually relatively new, because as I told you, was forgotten for a long time, was used mainly for systems where you didn't need a good energy momentum resolution. Just to prove, like for example, this Rajba case, which is a nice example of showing that you have the two-spin band, but it doesn't really add that much. So the question is, how can you push the frontier of the technique and make it equivalent to what we can do with actors today? So this is a project in which I started to work actually 20 years ago when I first arrived in Berkeley. And the idea was, how can we build a new system that allows us to measure the spin with the same level of accuracy, which means energy and momentum resolution, and we can do with actors. And so the whole idea was to forget this principle on which people were working in different design, completely different detector. So the idea we had together with the little center, the advanced light source, was let's go back here and see in which point we are losing count. So what is causing this poor efficiency of this detector? And there are two ways where this happens. The first one is obviously here. Because when you use this in the spherical analyzer, what you are doing, you are choosing the potential to select the electron you want to make it here. So if you want to move a function of energy moment, so you want to select a particular electron. So the reality is that a lot of electrons are emitted, but you select the one you are interested in this electron. You don't take everything. So you lose already a count of 100 here, the factor of 100 here. Now you go through this spin orbit interaction, which is not so such an effective interaction, and you lose another count here. So you end up with a very low count. So the idea was, well, let's change both of these. And to change this hemispherical analyzer, there is another way of collecting electrons. And these are the so-called time-of-flight analyzer, which has been developed also a long time ago. And we just developed it appropriate for our type of experiment. The idea is that you have to use a tube, and whatever electron comes out from your solid, it will go through the tube. And it goes through the tube, and you are just measuring time. How much time it takes for the electron to go from here to here. And time obviously is related to velocity. So that's in a direct way you can extract the energy in the velocity of your system. So the first idea is change this one, just putting a tube. So everything that comes out from a material will go through the tube. And the second idea here, how do I extract the information about the speed? The idea was to forget about the spin orbit coupling, which is not very efficient, and the main thing is that you need to access accelerate the electron and relativistic energy in order to process the atomic gallery was to use the exchange scattering. There was actually a group in Italy, in Milan, that was working on a variety of magnetic material, and they were trying to build the device. And I knew this group because of when I was doing my PhD back in Italy. And so we thought, okay, why don't we use the same thing they are doing? They are doing for another purpose. So why don't we take exactly the same concept and we apply it here? So the idea was to use the exchange scattering now. So you look at the exchange scattering and electronium in order to do the same thing. And when you combine all of this, the system you come up with is this sort of system. So this sort of system, the way it works now, it can work actually in two different ways. So here you have your sample. So these are the photons coming. Now, all the electrons coming out are collected through my tube. And the system actually can work in two separate forms. If the electron just make it through here, I can do a standard RTS experiment. If I make the electron bend through here, they come here, there is a target, which I magnetize a positive through the exchange scattering, then I can extract the different components of the system. So when we do this, now I will show you the type of data we can take. So these are always looking at the system here. These are the type of data we can look at. And what is very nice is that we can take this spectra in just 3 minutes. So you have improved a lot of the energy momentum and also the time in which you can collect this. So now you can really go back and try to do the same thing that you can do with others. So this is obviously not such an interesting system. It's bolder, but just to show what you can do now. You can actually take full map, just looking at one spin component. So here, for example, from the spin up or spin down, you can look at the polarization, or you can look at both components together. So now it makes it appealing because you can go back and study many systems which are interesting. So I want to just give you a flash on the topological generator, which is the work we did last year, and it was very nice work. So this has been the group of Sahida San in Princeton, and done a lot of beautiful artist work to look at the Dirac experiments in this topological disorder to have the surface, the surface electrons. And they've done several things, followed by many other groups like CH and also Stanford. They actually started to dot the material, trying to reduce the gap. And this is just to give you an idea. There is really a lot, I could talk an hour about the system, but just to give you an idea of how beautiful the type of experiments you can do with artists. Obviously, the question that came from the theorist, well, we know that there is this spin texture, can you actually show that you have this spin texture? And so the first experiment was done actually by Dalina San, in collaboration with the group in Switzerland, and they used one of this minimal detector to look at the spin texture. So, because of what these are artist data, because of what I told you before, it's harder to get that with the previous system, the minimal, a full mapping. So you just have to be very selective in the experiment. And because they want to prove this spin texture, they just took two spectra here and here. So the idea was to show that actually you have this spin texture. And by doing so, they confirmed the predicted spin texture. There have been a lot of work following up, and there have been a lot of issues actually related with this. Because one thing you can do, you can extract information on the polarization. And different experiments have led to completely different results. So you go from validity and the same material, experiment that they claim a 20% polarization to experiment claiming 80% polarization. And a part of it isn't due to the not so good energy momentum resolution, but the part is due to something else. And I'll show you in a moment more. So obviously our new system is beautiful to apply to this system, to this material, and that's what we need. So I want to, for a moment, just to focus on this part here. So these are the RTS data we can get with the straight tube of the detector on this material here. Here are pointed somewhere down here. These are the spin RTS data. We are looking here at the polarization map. These are taken with light that is depolarized. Now, when you do this, you see that you have here a blue branch and here a red branch. So I'm looking at the polarization. And this is nothing else that you want but looking at the spin texture that tells you on the left you have a blue, so you have speed up, for example. On the right, you have red, so you're speeding down. And so, when we look at this type of polarization, this is the same polarization measured by the 10 different papers that are available. And so, just looking at this polarization, we have prepared to say we go up to the theory. But one thing we wanted to do was to, because we were actually looking at other materials. So the idea was translated here. What happens if you change the polarization of light? Can you actually think with this field? And what we are showing you here is if we maintain a S-polarized light, we are actually completely flipping this picture. So if you use this polarization, you would have this component down and this part down. So in a way, if you want, was fortunate that the first experiment we were all taken here for the first 3 years and confirm whatever was observed by theory. Now what is nice is that actually I've ended it here because this is not going to be the main focus, but if you start to play with circular polarized right, left and right polarization, you can actually create components that are completely out of the plane. So you can completely reverse the polarization out of the plane, up or down. Or if you play polarization in medium, you can really create now whatever spin texture you want. You just play with the polarization of light. So this is an example of how one has to be careful when interpreting the experiment when you don't have a full availability of, which in this case, of momentum resolution because of the limited efficiency of the data. There is much more that can come from the experiment. And actually what we are doing now, we are trying to couple this with the path and probe that I have set up to be able to do path and probe in our experiment. And this is a challenge, and it's one way to go. One thing actually that is very nice, eventually, based on this idea, many other detectors, I think there is another one actually in Germany that is based on a similar concept, actually slightly different the detector, but there are many actually from a private company, there is a big push now to develop the better and better today. So this is very nice because probably 5 years from now we are going to see spin up because it's really going to open a completely new field like artists did 15 years ago.
I was just going to ask, what's the resolution, base space resolution for this thin polarization maps?
So, yes.
Because the cartoon that you have, with, I guess that's a cartoon, circular lines would say that they're double functions, right? So what's the resolution actually experimental?
So the momentum resolution you can get is 0.02 angstrom to the minus 1. It's very comparable to others. And the energy resolution is, at the moment we operate with 7 to 10 milliliters. But there is no reason to go. But it's very comparable to others. It's very
Probably a business issue, but are you claiming that the light can actually flip the polarization of the surface state?
No, it's the photoelectron. I think the polarization of the upcoming photoelectron.
I see. Okay.
Yes.
So how do you avoid that? What, how do you avoid flipping the outgoing photoelectron flipping it wrong?
You cannot avoid it because in this particular case, actually, this photoelectron will be coupled with the light. So there are materials where this doesn't happen. You actually don't flip it. But in this particular material, by just the polarization of light, you can flip the outcome of the
photoelectron. Before it leaves the sun?
You are not flipping the surface electron. So surface electron and well-defined spin texture.
Yes.
So you are not flipping it.
So it's processing as it comes out, is that what you're saying?
Well, this opens a big debate because there are many theories actually out there why this happened. There's been a lot of controversy, which is because of the spin-off interaction, it's because purely because of the Hamiltonian of the system. It's, you know, there are many theories out there. And I don't think there is an agreement why this happened.
Okay.
So you could do single photon.
Yes,
will this still happen?
Single photon artists. I believe so, yes. I mean again, if you go back to what is actually the reason that this is happening, but that is, yeah, I believe so. So actually, I can say a few other things. It's very interesting because going back to you, we are now studying the other system, and this very selective momentum. So if I operate at small k, I see this. Suppose I have a material where, for whatever reason, I create a replica of the cone. This, I don't observe this phenomenon. I observe this phenomenon only for small k. As soon as I move to large k, I get actually the exact speed texture.
Right.
So we have material where you can create some sort of superstructure, and you see that the main component is little, and the other component you're not changing it. Mm. Or you can add system, we are actually playing a different system, where within the same cone, if you create somehow, you can change the cone, you can move the camera potential up down, so you can change which part you're probing. You see the top to one point is flip and then it doesn't flip anymore. Mm. So I think it's still completely open in the way the world. Okay, so let me move now to the next part, which is time. And so the idea is pretty much to borrow what optical spectroscopy has done for many, many years. And simply what optical spectroscopy is a photolinear photonic technique, but the basic system you have there is the same. The only difference is you probe electron out. But you want to have the pump that excites the probe that measures the system. And when you do this, here they measure the reflectivity of the absorption. Well, in our case, we are going to measure the photocurrent. It's like we do with an artist experiment, so if you want the change of the photocurrent, but you can still get information about generation and recombination of the photocurrent. So the basic idea is the same. The only thing is we need, first of all, to be able to have a system that allows you to have a proper experiment. And obviously, the most obvious thing is laser. So this is relatively new, because up to, I would say, 2005, the work that the tower is done in 2007, this type of laser can be very effective, and in some cases, even better than synchrotron light in the study of the laser. So this is really actually the first experiment done with a laser. Material is a material that is dear to all Photoemission community, which is a beautiful to do one too. So it's very easy to believe. It's been studied for 30 years, and we most of the time know we are going to get a nice and sharp feature. So here you see that is a dispersion around this gamma y direction, so every layer is zero, and you have this very nice and sharp feature. Now, to compare, these are the data taken at the synchrotron at different photolayers. So, probably will strike you right away the fact that actually in this particular case, the laser end up giving much sharper data than you can get at the synchrotron. And so, this is obviously proving that the laser can be very good for some type of experiment if this energy is actually accurate. There are a lot of things not good, and I'll discuss later on, but there are many experiments for which it is well. So now we end up with a system that has improved momentum resolution, much, much sharper figure by a factor of 8, and has been applied a lot. There are several works, for example, done by the HM group at Stanford, and one nice thing that has come out that now you can look at features that the sequence on light were masked. For example, for a long time, there has been a debate in the field of rays that as you move across the phase diagram, go from a very low doping all the way to high doping, the Fermi velocity doesn't change. And this is what was called the universal Fermi velocity, and the global average called this is the quantum predictor rate. And so the big question is, how come you have a system that goes from being almost an insulator to through a superconducting phase to become a metal and return it off to exactly the same as possible. So a couple of years ago, with this improved momentum resolution, they actually published a paper showing that now with the laser you can actually resolve the small change of the Fermi velocity, and indeed the Fermi velocity is not protected, but it's changing when you evolve through the big diagram. And there are many other features that have been observed, one of which is the nature of the new wave gap, and I will go back to it in a moment. So now we can do this type of experiment. So let's try to couple it. So now here have two beams, if you want. One is here as a pump and one as a probe. And the question is, what can you do? And so here I just, you can do a lot, but here let me just summarize three things on which I will focus. The first thing you can do, you can look at the quasi-particle dynamics in a little bit in a similar fashion to what spectroscopy is doing, but now you can resolve the quadrivalve in momentum, and very important in energy. So you can, for example, look at change of the intensity of your spectrum. Other thing you can do, you can look at the gap. And so you can look at how the gap changes the volume when you pump your system. You can see that one, so change, dynamic change of the gap. And finally, you can look at many-body interaction and ask yourself how in the many-body interaction change. And look into the future, how you can selectively pump a specific mode and whether this will cause some change or some phase transition in your system. An optical experiment can do today, but that is not still do today. So I will pass a few of these things. And if we look at the literature, there has been, I would say, in the last 4 years or so, really a lot of the time responders experiment, artists experiment, and most of them have studied the transmitted wave materials. And there is actually also to study the iron peroxide. There has been some experiments on the breakout of the fluid. Original experiment by the Wolf group on the graphite. And all of these experiments, actually, I would say, really, Martin Wolf has been the one who has pushed the technique for many years. And so these are beautiful work, and shown that in some cases, like this one, that you can melt the child density wave, show how actually the last structure changed, and how you recover back with the child density wave opening. And these are beautiful experiments, but cannot be applied to some class of material, like, for example, to brace superconductors. And the reason for this is they can be applied, but they won't give you a lot of information. And the reason for this is summarized here, because the setup, all these previous setup, operate in a range that they use some laser for which the momentum resolution is not very good, and the energy resolution is not very good. Remember, at the beginning, you have to select your laser in order to be able to operate in the same condition that darkness can do. And so this, for example, is a work that I'm doing by the Wolf group, on this the data quality. This is the standard data quality for this material. So if you want to look at a state of things happening near the first layer with the very primary electron box, this is probably not the system. And because of this lack of energy momentum resolution, and I'll go back to this in a moment, also because they were operating at very high fluids, they concluded that we are in some protected bottleneck regime, so not much can be extracted when you work with. So one thing we did, and this is really fortunate, that I was at the LDL, because we have experts like Joe Austin and the whole group of Daniel Chemba, that now is the leader is Robert Campbell. These are people who have worked forever, not only in the pump and probe optical spectroscopy, but also on these particular materials. So I was, up to a few years ago, and I'm actually still today, very ignorant about all the fields of laser. And I'm learning, I tell my students, I learn together with you, actually it's longer than you, my brain is halfway. So you have to teach me everything. But so when we started to, you know, we thought we were going to do this, obviously I didn't know anything, so I just went with my colleague across the hall and I asked them, what can we do? How can we do it? And so we sit together, obviously they learn about my system, I learn about their system, and we came up with this idea. And then I went back to them and said, wait a second, you know, there are all these groups publishing this paper. Why do you want me to do it in this way? Which has some limitation. I'll tell you what are the limitations in a moment. And why can't I just replicate what has been done? And they told me, because for a large variety of material, actually the fluid that you use is critical. So for example, for a superconductor, if the fluid you use is too high, you will end up heating the sample. And you heat the sample, obviously you enter in a normal state and you're doing nothing really. So either you pump your system with really, really high fluids, like Cavalieri is doing in Germany at the moment, and well, here's a completely different system. High fluids and particular pumping, you can pump specific forms, or forget about that, it's too far away after we're not going there today. The other thing you can do is you can be more selective and operate in a different regime. So we built this new system. So why did you have an amazing student who then became postdoctor and put the system, didn't know anything about that, for 6 months I had the system running. It was really type of laser that was used at initially, if you probed it for the initial webinar with the laser. And then through frequency patterning, now we have a pump and a probe. So the pump is 1.48 electron volt and the probe is 5.9 electron volt. So now we can do this type of experiment, and just to get a long story short, I don't have time. This is what we can do today, and this is what is possible to do with all these other systems that exist in terms of energy and momentum. So now we can really go back and say, wow, now we can really study in the same way you do with photoemission, and we pump and probe photoemission, the variety of material. So I'm going to focus in the next 15 minutes is on some study within the brain. So, briefly, what can you do? Now, just think about what I told you so far about photoemission. You can do exactly the same thing. The only difference is now you're adding time to your spectral function. And here, since there are several theories that I hope after this talk, then we start to work in different thoughts on pump and probe photoemission, because we are really lacking theories in this field at the moment. So the idea is pretty much, you look at the same thing. So if I focus on a specific momentum, this is a Fermi momentum, this is what a typical arc spectrum would look like along the northern direction for this material. But now when I do the pump and probe, actually, I have the same spectra, yes, but at different time. So all the negative time are equilibrium. I'm just coming in with a thing, which in this case is bump and probe, the same thing. And the positive time are, first I come in with the probe, and then I follow with the probe. So these are all the excited spectra from here that eventually relax back to equilibrium. This is the equilibrium spectra of equilibrium, and this is the equilibrium, almost equilibrium reached after a long time. So now I can start to do this, or simply I can start to look at how the dispersion evolves at the function of time. So in this particular material, for example, you start at equilibrium and there is a gap. And now after I pump it, there is a gap. Now I pump my system, the gap closes. And eventually with time, you see that the gap reopens space. So you can start to look at all these things. You can learn about the dynamic of the gap, how you can form the gap, which actually is different in different materials that we are studying. And in some material we are studying, I'll show you today, in different momentum regions, the gap closes in different ways. So you can do all of these things. So let me briefly go to look at the gap dynamics. I'm going to show you now data for a superconductor. This is the one too. Here at optimal doping, then we have time to look at different doping. So these are equilibrium actors spectra. From the one of you who are not familiar, this is the Fermi surface. Fermi surface is made by Fermi arc, and then you have this evolved off nodal or anti-nodal region where the superconducting gap is bigger. Here at the node, the gap is zero. So this spectra energy and momentum, this is taken at the node on this cut, the gap is zero. This is spectra at the Fermi level, crossing the Fermi level no gap. This spectra here is taken somewhere here near the tip of the Fermi arc. There is a small gap. And as you would move farther out here, you would see a bigger and bigger gap. And this is of the D-wave gap of this material. Now, limitation of this system. And this is just to tie back to the future part at the end of the talk. The momentum region you can access is determined by the laser energy. So if you have a laser that operates at 6 electron volts, you can convert this into momentum. And you see that the momentum region you can access with this laser is up to somewhere here. Part of the Fermi arc. So I can get with this laser to the antenna. So the only system actually can get to the antenna at the moment are system with harmonic iteration that will give us full the energy of the resolution. Actually, mainly energy resolution. So actually, then we cannot do this type of operation. So these are equilibrium data. Let me show you the equilibrium data in the standard way we do with ARCS, which is the symmetrization. So pretty much what you are doing, you are dividing by the Fermi function. So now, when you do this, you see there is a gap in C2B, so you see this part and this other part here. And if there is no gap, you see something across. So just for visual purpose to show you the data, I'm going to use this method. But no matter which method I use to determine the gap, they are all equivalent. So now I want to look at what happened to the gap when I pump. And so let me focus on this data here. These are the raw data, this is the price data. And now I look at the evolution of the spectra at the fraction of time.
collect data are the moment t equals zero. And then this is the puppet, the sample, and then these are outside equilibrium eventually revolved. Now you look at this data, and pretty much nothing happened. Maybe just a tiny bit. There is a tiny, tiny change from the black spectra to the moment right after the laser features. So not much. And I operate a very, very low fluence. Now let me increase the fluence. So when I increase the fluence, you start to see operator fluence. You start the number of the square. Now you see that more things start to change. Then you go on and go on, increase the fluence. So bottom line, summarizing it, this is what you see. When I operate here, I think it's 23 microjoules per million square fluence, I can fully close the gap. There are several interesting things, some of which we understand, some of which we still don't understand. So, these are the inner spectra, there is this gap. Now, here is the transfer spectra. You see that the gap closed and then eventually open again. What is interesting here is that the response of the gap is not immediate. If I study another material, like for example, MgV2, which we are doing now, you bump, the gap closes right away. The response is immediate. When I study this cooperator, this MgV2, and actually it depends also for the doping, the response of the gap is not immediate. It takes some time before the gap responds, it closes, and then eventually opens. And the response varies between 0.3 picoseconds to 0.5 picoseconds, depending also on the dose. So this is one thing that we still don't understand. Now, here I'm just showing you how the gap can fully close. So these are data taken here. Now you're looking at the gap as a function of time divided by the equilibrium gap. So once is when you start, the gap is completely open. Zero eventually will be when the gap is completely closed. So you see this data, different colors, different fluence. If I create a low fluence, I just suppress the gap by 20% or so. But if I start to create a high fluence, I completely close the gap. Now I want you to focus on two things, which again are these are the thing on which we are still working. First of all, is the delay. The gap doesn't close right away, as we observed in another system, but it takes some time before the gap responds. Then, if you take a BCS type superconductor, the gap responds right away, and then it will open eventually quite soon. Instead, the gap takes time to respond, then actually takes time to reopen again. So stay closed for some time, and eventually reopen again. So, one thing we can do, we can look at the component time scale. And when we do this, we see that there are two time scales that are involved. There is a fast time scale, which involves the closing of the gap and stay closed, and then there is a slower time scale. So at the moment, and this is still over, at the moment we are thinking probably what we see is nothing other than the transition to this type of potential to this type of Mexican system. So the two time scales that you have, one will be to go from the maximum here to go down to the minimum, and the other one if you want to turn on time. But this goes back to what I was telling you a minute ago, the big part of data that we don't understand. So there are two time scales that are associated actually with the dynamics of the gap. One is fast and one is closed. And the way the gap, I can close this gap, is completely different than what we observe now in some BCS types of superconductors. So these are two important things to keep in mind. And this is just another way of showing you that the gap you can actually, depending from the fluence, you can use the fluence as a tuning parameter or how much you want to close the gap. So if you operate with a small fluence, you just close by a little bit, a high fluence, you close it completely. Now, one thing is important, I told you at the beginning, you want to operate in a regime of fluence. And this is very important because if I start to operate at high fluence, I will heat up the sample. In all these experiments, the sample obviously, when I compare it with the laser, it's got the temperature is going to increase. But it's always below the critical temperature. So I'm still in the contact state in all of these cases. This is actually the reason why usually we don't like to go to much above 25 microjoules. But then we start to go to 90 kelvin and we can't keep on to get to. Now, one quick thing. So let me jump all of this. So if I go now at the outside the Fermi arc, So if I am inside the Fermi arc, I show you that the gap completely closed. But if I am outside the Fermi arc, actually, no matter how strong I cut, we went up to 45 microjoules per centimeter squared, I cannot close the gap. So outside the Fermi arc, the gap is always open. And what actually happened, which is kind of interesting, is that you see it here in this raw data. So here, the two peak, the distance peak to peak is the gap size. The two peak come together and close, and then open again. But when you are here, outside the Fermi arc, what you see is that there is a filling of the gap. So actually, the peak-to-peak distance doesn't change much, but you start to see that the gap starts to fill. Or if you want, you don't look also in this image of what's here. The gap is always open, and you start to create this idea. And the other thing that is very interesting, so one puzzle is why I cannot close the gap outside the Fermi arc. The second thing is, well, I see a completely different dynamic here. But the second interesting thing is that the time scale that it takes for the gap on the Fermi arc to close, remember I told you it's not immediate, it takes some time and then it closes, is exactly the same time scale in which here I start to look at filling. So although the dynamic and the way they respond to bumping is completely different, they have very similar time scale. And actually if I look at the recovery, the time scale from the recovery to go back to equilibrium in both cases, it's exactly the same. Same momentum, energy, and fluid dependence. So on one end, it looks like I'm looking at two different phases. Here I can control it and close it, and here actually I cannot do anything, I just fill in. But then when I go to look at time scale, or the behavioral function of blood influence and so on, everything seems to be the same. I cannot actually distinguish it between the two. And so this is really an important question mark on a lot of recent art study, where it was claimed that the gap is not the perfect D-wave gap, but you have a gap, one type of gap along with the Fermi arc and a different type of gap outside from the Fermi arc. And so probably the only thing that needs to be revised together. So I don't have much time, but the only last thing I probably want to show you in a moment is one thing with which I'm excited.
So it's not simple saying I take from the two guys and I bring above the effort.
there is some missing text. So now we are looking at the full momentum dependence, and still what is interesting is that the more you move away from the node, the bigger the amount of spectral weight is missing. So this maybe goes back to exactly about the long time from field theory, but you have to talk about also the state of very high energy, the modulus, or maybe there is something else at the node which we cannot access with the data. So there are a lot of puzzles, a lot of things. And finally, the last thing I want to show you here is that one thing we do with the laser, we can actually change the strength of this kink. So when we talk the system, what we observe is that the strength of this kink, or if you want the strength of interaction, can be changed. And what is very nice is that you can change it. So if you measure the Hubble constant, which is nothing else than the ratio, how much you are changing the dispersion. So if you change the gapping constant as a function of the laser fluence, or if you want the area of the self-energy, as a function of laser fluence, you see that when you start to exhaust zero is where the system is equilibrium. When you start to pump, the strength of the electron-motor interaction becomes bigger. So less and less you can change the dispersion up to this point here. And from this point on, no matter how you pump, nothing changes. And this is very striking because this is exactly what happens in the gap. So it seems that there is some sort of link, I don't know, direct or indirect within the tube, but this is telling you that when the gap is changing, so as I close the gap, at the node, where there is no gap, the electron-boson interaction responds and becomes weaker. And in the moment the gap is closed, the gap away from the node is closed, so the superconducting gap, there is no way I can change the electron. The two seem to be strictly connected one to the other. Since it's enough time to talk, let me conclude saying that there is a lot we can still do, and I just talked about this too. I think eventually combine all of this, start to introduce a new outside triggering parameter, and eventually, I think really the future will be to be very selective on the type of mapping we can do with the laser. So, designing by laser new material and studying the properties. Lastly, let me just acknowledge member of my group and collaborators that have done all this beautiful work. And actually Jeff is the one who put together in really no time the time resolve system. He has been an amazing student, an amazing postdoc, really smart. And at one point he decided the moment he went for actually when he got the job offer from Oxford, he came back and he told me, I want to make money. So he left completely his investment banking now, he's making a lot of money and he's very happy. Unfortunately for science. Chris was a student that was working with me and he is the one who put together the spin arc system. Now he's a staff at the Advanced Lysis Course and he's an amazing scientist. And when Tao is a new postdoc in the group and he's the one who has been doing some of this beautiful experiment I showed you together with Chris. And really, nothing that would be possible without collaboration with Joe, Robert, and Zahid from the experimental point of view. A continuous collaboration and discussion and disagreement and agreement with the guy of the experimental data. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much.
Sorry for taking so long.
I think we have time for two questions.
Yep.
Because I mean, we can look at the data and we know that there is no change due to data. I think eventually that can become a problem, and that's why I was saying also, depending on the type of laser you use and the experimental condition you work, it becomes a problem, or actually I know some groups that are trying to take it as an advantage to apply an electric field to your system. But the issue there is how you control it, so it might be.
Yeah, like every, this was a fascinating talk and it suggested many questions to me, so I have to pick one. your spectral function depends on frequency omega and also the binary speed. So basically, you have two time scales. So doesn't that mean that you have to worry a bit when those two time scales start to be similar? So if you have time scales of picoseconds, that's about a millielectron volt. So if you are looking, for example, at the dynamics of the gap when near the node, where it's going to zero, so then you worry that then the interpretation is not so straightforward because you have to see
that. Maybe in some cases, but most of the time scale I'm looking at here are the order of 10 to 0.
10 to 0.
One last one.
Okay. For spin resolve, work you need to conserve the spin. But you say that the spin is not conserved during photoemission. The polarization of the light can flip the spin. Mm-hmm. So
what do you mean by spin is not conserving the spin?
Yeah. You show that the spin can be flipped during the photoemission process.
Mm-hmm.
So how can we for sure to determine or to do this spin resolve process?
Oh, first of all, it's not for all material. Not all material we study is happening. Actually, there are some systems that don't flip at all. So, Steve Louis did a lot of calculations. This is the one actually we collaborated with us for this. And he saw that this is the property of the electronium of the topology of insulator that is interacting with the light, with the polarization of light. And that's what we flip it. But for many other systems, actually, this doesn't occur. This doesn't happen. So, well, in the case of topological insulator, what you can do, you can go back and extract the spin texture with very good precision with respect to the experiment. So if you want, actually, you have something more. You have an additional parameter which you can play with. But it doesn't happen in any system, unless, fortunately or unfortunately, but it doesn't happen in any system.
Thank you very much.
You.
We'll now break for lunch and be back here at 12:30 sharp to start the afternoon on our budget.